60s, expanded in the 70s and expanded further in the 80s, and they reached into other parts of the society and different issues. A lot of things that seemed outrageous in the 60s are taken for granted today. So, for example, take the feminist movement, for example, which barely began to exist in the 60s. Now it's part of general consciousness and awareness. The ecological movements began in the 70s. Third World Solidarity movements were very limited in the 60s. It was really Vietnam. In the 60s also, it was a student movement, as you say. Now it's not. Now it's mainstream America.
If there is more dissidence now than you can remember, why do you go on to write that the people feel isolated?
Because I think much of the general population recognizes that the organized institutions do not reflect their concerns and interests and needs. They do not feel that they participate meaningfully in the political system. They do not feel that the media are telling them the truth or even reflect their concerns. They go outside of the organized institutions to act.
We see more and more of our elected leaders know less and less of what they're doing.
Yeah, in fact, this medium
does that.
Very striking. In fact, the presidential elections have been almost removed from the point where the public even takes them seriously as involving a matter of choice.
So what do you think about what goes on in the White House?
It's kept too private, I think.
Yeah, they should come out.
I know.
People.
Yeah.
Who should talk to the people?
George Bush.
Well, it means that the political system increasingly functions without public input. It means to an increasing extent, not only do people not ratify decisions presented to them, but they don't even take the trouble of ratifying them. They assume that the decisions are going on independently of what they may do in the polling booth.
Ratification would be what?
Well, ratification would mean a system in which there are two positions presented to me, the voter. I go into the polling booth and I push one or another button depending on which of those positions I want. That's a very limited form of democracy. Really meaningful democracy would mean that I play a role in forming those decisions and making creating those positions. And that would be real democracy.
That's not
we're very far from that. But we're even departing from the point where there is ratification. When you have stage-managed elections with the public relations industry determining what words come out of people's mouth, candidates decide what to say on the basis of tests that determine what the effect will be across the population. Somehow people don't see how profoundly contemptuous that is of democracy.
The solemn moment is near, but first, the swearing-in of Van Quayle.
Please move to your seats.
For the first time in this century, for the first time in perhaps all history, man does not have to invent a system by which to live.
We don't have to talk late into the night about which form of government is better. We don't have to wrest justice from the kings. We only have to summon it from within ourselves. This is a time when the future seems a door you can walk right through. A room called tomorrow. Great nations of the world are moving toward democracy, through the door to freedom. The people of the world agitate for free expression and free thought, through the door to the moral and intellectual satisfactions that only liberty allows. We know how to secure a more just and prosperous life for man on earth through free markets. Free speech, free election, and the exercise of free will unhampered by the state. I've spoken of a thousand points of light, of all the community organizations that are spread like stars throughout the nation doing good. To the world, too, we offer new engagement and a renewed vow. We will stay strong to protect the peace. The offered hand is a reluctant fist. America is never wholly herself unless she is engaged in high moral principles. We as a people have such a purpose today. It is
to make kinder the face of the nation gentler the face of the world.
Referring back to your earlier comment about escaping from or doing away with capitalism, I was wondering what scheme, workable scheme, you would put in its place.
Me?
Or
well, what I would, yeah.
What, well, what you would know, you suggest to others who might be in a position to set it up and get it going?
Well, I mean, I think that what used to be called centuries ago wage slavery is intolerable. I mean, I don't think people ought to be forced to rent themselves in order to survive. I think that the economic institutions ought to be run democratically by their participants, by the communities in which they exist, and so on. And I think basically through various kinds of free association.
Historically, have there been any sustained examples on any substantial scale of societies which approximated to the anarchist ideal?
There are small societies, small in number, that have, I think, done so quite well, and there are a few examples of large-scale libertarian revolutions which were largely anarchist in their structure. As to the first, small societies extending over a long period, I myself think the most dramatic example is perhaps the Israeli kibbutzim, which for a long period, may or may not be true today, really were constructed on anarchist principles, that is, of direct worker control, integration of agriculture, industry, service, personal life on an egalitarian basis with direct and, in fact, quite active participation in self-management, and were, I should think, extraordinarily successful. A good example of a really large-scale anarchist revolution, or largely anarchist revolution, in fact, the best example, to my knowledge, is the Spanish Revolution in 1936. And, in fact, you can't tell what would have happened. That anarchist revolution was simply destroyed by force, but during the period in which it was alive, I think it was inspiring testimony to the ability of poor working people to organize, manage their affairs extremely successfully without coercion and control.
How far does the success of libertarian socialism or anarchism as a way of life really depend on a fundamental change in the nature of man, both in his motivation, his altruism, and also in his knowledge and sophistication?
I think it not only depends on it, but in fact the whole purpose of libertarian socialism is that it will contribute to it. It will contribute to a spiritual transformation, precisely that kind of great transformation in the way humans conceive of themselves and their ability to act, to decide, to create, to produce, to inquire, precisely that spiritual transformation that social thinkers from the left Marxist tradition, from Luxembourg, say, on over through anarcho-syndicalists have always emphasized. So on the one hand, it requires that spiritual transformation. On the other hand, its purpose is to create institutions which will contribute